Today we are looking at Colossians. The book of Colossians exalts Christ over everything, over all of the forces of this life, all of the gods of this life, all of the philosophies of this life, all of the heavens itself. In that very religiously impacted society, very superstitious society, it proclaims that Jesus Christ is Lord of all. And it's magnificent the way it exalts King Jesus. Colossians, I think, really of all the letters of the Apostle Paul, all the letters of the New Testament, exalts the person of Jesus the most. It is the most Christ-centered letter that I can think of any of these letters. This is the one that I look at when I think of Christ-centeredness. Isn't the rest of the New Testament all Christ-centered? Absolutely. Not just the New Testament, all of the Old Testament too, but especially Colossians exalts Jesus like none other. Yep. I would say that, and I think I can say that without any qualification. Here, in the text that we are looking at today, we're looking at it today and tomorrow. We'll divide it into two. It tells us that we have died in Christ to worldly religiosity. We have died in Christ to worldly religiosity, and we have been raised such that we can seek the eternal things above. Those two parts. Die to worldly religiosity and been raised to seek the things, to place our hope in the things that are eternal and above. We take the first part today. In Christ, we have died to worldly religiosity. Verse 20. If with Christ you have died to the elemental spirits of the world, why, as if you were still alive in the world, do you submit to regulations? Do not handle, do not taste, do not touch, referring to the things that all perish as they are used, according to human precepts and teachings. These have indeed an appearance of wisdom in promoting self-made religion and asceticism and severity to the body, but they are of no value in stopping the indulgence of the flesh. Everything that was described here has to do with man-made, this world-oriented religiosity. Oh, but it's very often said that Christianity is not a religion. And people can argue about that. But I would say it slightly differently. I think I can hold to this one a little better. Christianity is not religiosity. Religiosity is against Christianity. And Christianity is against religiosity. The trappings of religion that are tied to this world and tie you to this world. All kinds of superstitions, all kinds of fear that demons and powers beyond your control are going to have their way in your life. The people of this age, this time, would look up at the stars and see them as eyes of the gods looking down on them. And can you imagine that? What that will do to your psyche? That the gods are looking at you all the time. And that's how they would see the stars. And they would wear all kinds of amulets and buy all kinds of potion books and spells and just all this money they would spend on superstitious religions. And not only just stuff that you would buy on the street, but proper religions, sponsored, endorsed religions, state religions, and personal religions, all of these things cost so much money and cost so much of their lives. And they were giving their lives to them. Not only they, but we do the same thing. There's so much vain religiosity going on all around us. Just look up and down the street. You can see psychics everywhere. They're all making money. That's why they're able to stay in business, selling nothing, pretty much. Selling influence, whatever influence they have. Yeah, and that is the same everywhere else in the world too. All these things to try to make you, try to help you to live your better life here and now. None of them really claiming to do anything for you in the hereafter, pretty much. And even if they claim it, they can't make good on any of those claims if they claim to be of any use outside of this life. Remember all of the possessions that were buried to the pharaohs? Eventually, they only made the robbers rich who raided the tombs. Much the same way today, we live for vain things. Empty cisterns, the Bible says, broken cisterns that can hold no water. That's what the idols of our lives, religiosity, ultimately are. But Pastor Paul, isn't there some truth in all religion? Yes. What? Pastor Paul says there's truth in all religion. Yes. The Bible says those are a shadow. They all point to a reality. They are a shadow of the reality, but they are not the reality. The reality is Christ. Verse 17, these are a shadow of the things to come, but the substance belongs to Christ. And because you have trusted in Jesus as Lord and Savior, we have the substance. We have the reality. And look at verse 23. These have indeed an appearance of wisdom in promoting self-made religion. In promoting self-made religion. But they do no good spiritually. Promoting self-made religion, but they do no good spiritually. You know, I can't help but remember, I was at a wedding with all love to my Roman Catholic friends and those of my brothers and sisters with Roman Catholic backgrounds. I was sitting in a Roman Catholic wedding, and the priest actually said, "Now we will greet Mother Mary. We will greet Mother Mary with flowers. We will offer her flowers." The person I was sitting with said, "Is Mother Mary going to come out from behind that curtain?" The bride and groom took the basket of flowers, and like we offer them to our parents during a Korean Western kind of wedding, they offered it to a painting that was hidden behind a curtain. I want to ask, where is that in the Bible? Where is that in the Bible? Why do we make up stuff? Why do we make things up? There's enough stuff in the Bible that is hard to believe. Why do we have to go out of our way to make things up, following our own sense of what is spiritual, what is not, what is holy, what is not? Please, can we stay with the scriptures and therefore with the things that God himself has said are the eternally significant things? I think we can. I think we should. And yes, we will fail in many ways because our vain imaginations tend toward idolatry all the time. But even so, we can, by the grace of God, try and do it more and more and stay more biblical and stay, therefore, more focused on the eternal things. Anything that terminates with their focus on here and now, if the end goal is to help you to live a better life and to hear it now, those are, at the end, distractions from true spirituality that is in Christ, fully grounded with Christ in eternity. So we'll focus our eyes tomorrow on chapter 3 that says, if then you have been raised with Christ. I love the beautiful pairing. Will you see it? Right here in verse 20, if with Christ you have died. And then chapter 3, verse 1. If then you have been raised, if you have died, if you have been raised in Christ, death and life. This is the dynamic of the Christian life. It's cruciform. It's in the shape of the cross, isn't it? And I pray that you would display the cross everywhere you go. No, not just in necklaces like I've got or emblems on your car, but in your life and in your thought and from your heart. Loving him with everything that you've got. This way, you will seek him that is above, with whom you have been raised to eternal life. You have died to worldly religiosity. You have been raised with Jesus to eternity. By the grace of God, live it. Heavenly Father, how prone we are to superstitious, superficial spirituality, idolatry. How easily we are afraid of forces that we feel are out of your control, when we know, and we know by faith, that there is nothing outside of your control. So help us to recognize it. Set our eyes on you, seated in heaven, and know that all of our lives are also hidden in you, and so by your grace, unshakable. Help us to live out of this confidence today. Make all the changes that need to be made to walk a little bit more closely with you, because you deserve it. We celebrate you and love you. We say no to all of the temporary temptations and distractions, and say yes to you alone. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Touch my heart like you do. I can search for all eternity long. I'll find there is none like you. Your mercy flows like a
eternity alone.